Bibles, please, to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. While you're turning there, let me say that this Sunday is the last full worship service that Clifton Scroggins will be with us. He, Lord willing, will be here next Sunday for the song portion of the service, but we'll have to leave during the service to go and catch a ride to Oklahoma City, where he will be formally inducted into the Army and begin his boot camp, and then training after that will be away for 6 months, and then after 6 months will be deployed. Only the Lord knows where they will send him for his first duty station. So if you have an opportunity today, I want you to thank Clifton. In fact, let's thank him now. We appreciate his service as a part of our worship team. We're going to miss him, but we're excited about how God's going to use him wherever he takes him from here. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Stand with me, if you would, verses 1 to 9. We began looking at this last week, and we didn't get through it. It was kind of an ambitious undertaking, I realize, on the Sunday that we celebrate the Lord's Supper. But I thought I would give it a try. So we're here to finish this up today. Next Sunday, Easter Sunday, we will gaze into the Scripture and celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ and ask ourselves those questions that must be asked of every human being on the planet. Who is Jesus Christ? What did he come to do? And then the key question, a lot of people know that in their heads. What difference has that made in your life? Because if the answer is none, then Paul will make it very plain about what hope we have then. So, prepare your hearts even now. Today's Palm Sunday, by the way, in the Orthodox Church around the world. Palm Sunday, I saw a little video that popped up earlier today for our brothers in Haiti, a live video of their worship, and they were actually carrying palm fronds down through the aisles of their church to celebrate Palm Sunday. It's a great day, a high day, high holy day for the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, but it's also a tragic day today because in Egypt, at least two Coptic Christian churches were bombed by ISIS, and the death toll is climbing. They were gathered for their Palm Sunday worship to celebrate the time when Jesus made the triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and these barbaric people, and I use people lightly, seized the opportunity when people were celebrating the high holy day of Palm Sunday to set off bombs and kill dozens, and no telling how high the death toll will climb. So, thank God that we worship in relative peace. It's a privilege. It's not a right. 1 Corinthians 3, 1 to 9, if you would follow along in your Bibles as I read. If you don't have your Bibles, we've got it on the screen for you. But I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. And even now you are not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not being merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. This is the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient Word of God. May we hear it today. Hear the warning that the bells that Paul sounds to this church in Corinth about the devastating consequences of jealousy and strife and divisions in a local assembly. And then let us hear and learn again the antidote to that, the difference in that. Thank you. Please be seated. We're thinking today about man-centered versus God-centered thinking. Last week we told you that the sin of division never finds itself alone. It's always connected to other sins. They're interrelated. One leads to another. Every sin, in fact, is a combination of sins. And so from chapter 1, verse 18 to chapter 2, verse 16, he's pointing out that the Corinthians were divided because of worldliness, that worldly philosophy that we talked about, that worldly thinking. In chapter 3, verses 1 to 9, he addresses another aspect of this. You just turn the diamond, the facet, he's looking at this idea of the flesh, this acting like an unconverted person. He recognizes that the only way that manifests itself in the life of a Christ follower is if that Christ follower is in what would be called a retarded infancy. There's not a growth taking place there. You would know immediately if a child of 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 still in diapers, that is not normative. That is not normative. And Paul's basically talking about that to the Corinthian believers. He's trying to challenge them to not take the way of the world, not act the way. Are you not acting as human, not just merely human? In other words, you're acting like an unconverted person. I told you last week, my mentor, R.F. Gates, when we would find ourselves in a crisis in the church, dealing with somebody who was being difficult to deal with and cantankerous, and he would look at me and say, "Now, Bill, did that person have to get saved to be that way? Or could they have been that way as an unsaved person?" And the answer is obvious. It was a rhetorical question. Acting like an unsaved person. One of my favorite comedians is Brian Regan. You watch him on YouTube, disclaimers, sometimes he drifts a little bit in some of his things, but one of his funniest skits to me is one, he says, "Beware of the me monster." And he goes into this very dramatic illustration of people who are always, it's always about them. He's the person who is always talking about himself. You know, we say that person's eyes are too close together. I this, I that. And no matter what anyone else says, we'll strive to top it by, "Oh yeah, well that's nothing." And then tell something greater than that. It's a hysterical skit. But the truth behind it is not funny at all. The truth is that we live in a very self-centered society. People want things to go their way. And there's a growing sentiment that the world owes me. And therefore you owe me. A society where this attitude prevails gives rise to a very restless and dissatisfied culture. There's a better way. And we're going to look at that today. You're familiar with General William Booth, who was the founder of the Salvation Army. I told you this story before in the past, but I want you to hear it again today. It's pertinent for this. He was in poor health, and so it was impossible for him to attend the annual convention. One of his associates suggested that he send a telegram to be read at the opening of the convention in order to encourage the many who would be gathered there in hopes of hearing him speak. He agreed. When the thousands of delegates met, the moderator announced that General Booth could not be present due to his failing health. Gloom and pessimism swept across the convention floor. Until the moderator announced that Booth had sent a telegram to be read at the start of the first session. The moderator opened the telegram and read it. It contained just one word: others. Others. Those who were gathered there sat initially in stunned silence. His message then was just one word. But gradually the mood in the convention hall changed as it dawned on person after person that this one word perfectly summed up the life and mission of General Booth. Others. His very existence was about others. He learned from his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught that he did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And Paul's concern in Corinth was that these people were not acting like Jesus Christ. They were putting themselves first. They were putting their preferences first, particularly as it related to preachers, which preacher they liked best. General Booth on that night was challenging his Salvation Army to be like Jesus Christ, sharing the good news in the context of serving others. I don't know who said it first, but I came across this years ago. It was true then, it's very, very true today. People really don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And true concern, real, lasting, valuable concern, comes from a God-centered way of thinking. Man-centered thinking will only be concerned about others in terms of what others can do for me. What will I gain in value from others? So last week we laid out the outline for you. Man-centered thinking stunts spiritual development. We looked at that. Man-centered thinking stirs division. We looked at that. When he says in those verses that he couldn't address them as spiritual people. He doesn't deny. In fact, he says, but I have brothers. The fact that he calls them brothers means that he believed they were Christians. He was willing to grant the benefit of the doubt, believe the best about them, that they were Christians. But he said, I couldn't speak to you as Christians, but as people of the flesh, as the unconverted that I encounter, wherever I go into pagan cities, I meet people like you all the time, as infants in Christ. I can't even feed you the meat that you might begin to put on some serious muscle onto that bone. I can only give you milk. And it saddens me that you're still not ready for the meat. He went on to say there's jealousy and strife among you. And when that happens, when we see it, aren't you just acting in a human way? That's what you were like when you were unconverted. Unconverted people all over the known world where Paul was traveling were just like that. And it breaks his heart to look into a church that he labored for a year and a half to found to see that that is manifesting itself there. Self-centeredness is at the heart of fleshly behavior. Jealousy, one person said, is an attitude. Jealousy. Strife is the action that results from it. Watch a child in the nursery. Serve some time in the church nursery here. Just watch it. Several of those little precious beings are my grandchildren. But just watch them. They're perfectly content with what they have until they see another child with something else. Jealousy sets in. And when jealousy sets in, guess what happens? Strife. Mine. They go and grab mine. We'll push a child over sometime to get at what they think is theirs, even though it wasn't in their hands. That's what Paul's talking about in Corinth. We look at the church, we look at the church nursery and go, gee, that shouldn't happen. Come on, we've got to work with these. When you say that in the church body of adults, it's not cute. It's tragic. It's deadly. It's devastating. That's what Paul's dealing with in the church in Corinth. We're going to look at the remedy for that, though. That's the next thing he takes up in verses 5 to 9. God-centered thinking destroys man-centered thinking. He says, what then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. Very interesting term there. Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. And what he's talking about here is the sovereignty of God in salvation. Paul preached, and the Lord assigned, according to Paul, those who were being saved. Apollos preached, the same thing. Paul says, you're giving preachers credit when you should be giving God credit. God's the one who saves. Paul doesn't save. He's already made that case earlier in the book. Apollos doesn't save. Peter doesn't save. Only God saves. As Acts 12:48 says, as many as were ordained to eternal life believe. God's the one who saves sinners. Paul, Peter, Apollos are mouthpieces, instruments that God's pleased to use. We're looking on Sunday nights now at the kings and the prophets, and looking tonight at 2 Kings. These prophets, many times, ultimately, their ministry was about judgment, and not many people turned. In fact, the fact that the people did not turn, what led to their destruction. We're going to look at that tonight. And the one prophet who was very hesitant and reluctant and didn't want to go and didn't want to preach to Nineveh and was afraid that if he did, that they would have a big outbreak and turn to God. God got him there anyway. He preached. And he was moping under a tree after it was over. Why are you here? Well, I knew what you'd do. God's the one who gives the increase. That's Paul's point here. He says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. Now watch what this does here. This should shift our perspective to see those servants whom God has placed in servant leadership positions as gifts of God, as Paul talks about it in Ephesians 4. He's the one who gave gifts to the church. He mentions apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastor, teachers. But they're his gifts. He warns the church in Ephesus in Revelation 2 that if they do not repent and return to loving him more than anything and anyone else, that he will remove their lampstand. He will take the light of their witness out from their midst. And for centuries, brothers and sisters, for centuries there was no gospel witness in Ephesus. So it does this to us. It makes us to look at his gifts and go through them to him. And if there's reason to give praise and honor and glory and thanks, then we give it to God. But it flows back a different way as well. Our tendency to grumble at his gifts, as if we've been shortchanged, is an assault upon him as the giver. And Paul is dealing with this corrective. And he has to deal with it both ways, by the way, because in Corinthians, you see it really coming out in 2 Corinthians, he talks about these super apostles, these guys that came in behind him and tried to undercut his ministry, slandering him. And he warns the Corinthians. Here he's reminding them that the people that they're lining up behind saying, I like Apollos better than Paul. Paul says, when you start that kind of talk, I like this preacher better than another, you're putting more stock in them when you should be putting more stock in God. If they were useful in your life, praise God for that. And go no further. Neither he who plants nor he who waters anything, but only God gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. We are God's fellow workers. Laborers together with God, that's the language the New Testament uses to talk about those whom God raises up. It's interesting the two analogies that he uses. God's field. He's made more specific the implication of that. As he said, one waters, one sows, another waters. God gives the increase. So the hope of any church is not how good the pastor, the effect of the pastor is. In fact, neither is the hopelessness of a church how bad the communicator of the pastor is. As one old preacher told me years ago, he said, you know, son, he said, God makes some pretty straight licks with crooked sticks. That ought to be a great encouragement to you and me. We sang it a while ago. Our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Paul talks about it in the Ephesians that the gospel he's preaching is based upon, built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. The truth of the prophets, the Old Testament, the truth of the apostles, the New Testament. But it only sits as significant and powerful truth to the extent that it lines up in line with the cornerstone, that chief stone, Peter says, the builders rejected. But it is the cornerstone. It is the measurement where every other stone goes from there. You can have a church built on a lot of stuff, but if it's not built squared to Jesus Christ as Lord, as the cornerstone, then it's not a healthy building. It may look so from the outside, just like Jesus said in Matthew 7. Talked about two houses. Both look the same. Both look safe. But when the rains came, when the floods came and the winds came, there was one house that was built upon the sand. The foundation of it was shaky. And it fell like a house of cards when the difficulty came. Another one was built upon the rock of Jesus Christ. Those same winds came, the same floods came, the same rains came, and it stood. And the difference was, one was built, if you want to take that analogy and apply it here, one was built upon the preaching of a person. One was built upon the gifts of a person. One was built upon the activities ginned up. The other was built on Jesus Christ. And it will always stand. It will always stand. You can take tours through Europe now. There are more mosques in London than there are Christian worship facilities. Once great cathedrals stand as museums. At one time, they were great edifices that housed people where the gospel was powerfully preached. But when that ceases to be, when another agenda comes in its place, and jealousy and strife and favoritism and party spirit and those things begin to well up, they will become in time empty cathedrals. The only hope of any congregation, the hope of this congregation, is that we be sure, first of all, our hearts are squared to Jesus Christ, the cornerstone. That he's the cornerstone in our lives. It's got to start there. Because it's just wishful thinking to think a ministry would be squared on that if we're in that ministry and we're not. But if that is happening, if in your life and my life, our lives are squared to Jesus Christ, when we come together as that, then the outflow, the working out of the ministry will be squared to him. By the way, just historically real quickly, that is why you hear from this pulpit, you hear in our Bible study classes, you hear in prayer times, you hear this talk about growing as a disciple, becoming increasingly a disciple maker, or for some, becoming initially a disciple maker. Because that is squared to the last command Jesus gave us on this earth before he ascended into heaven. As you go, make disciples of all nations. Remember, make disciples is the command verb there. It's not a suggestion. It'd be nice if you tried it. I think you'd like it if you did. I think you'd feel better. No. As you go, disciple the nations. Make disciples. And he walks us through briefly baptizing them. What do you do when a person confesses faith in Christ? You baptize them into the name of the triune God. You immerse them into that because they have confessed faith in Christ and committed to be his follower all the days of their lives. So you baptize them into the name of the triune God. And because they've been saved by grace through faith and become Christ followers, they have a student attitude. You show me a professing Christian who doesn't care to learn, I will show you a professing Christian who is a false convert. Teaching them to observe. It's not head knowledge. It never is for the follower of Jesus Christ that he is building. Teaching them to practice all that I have commanded you. And we look at that and we go, wow, all the commands of Jesus. How do we wrap around that? And some say, well, he summed it up for us, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, love your neighbor as yourself. And so he summarized his commands for us. And that's true. And he said in John's gospel, a new commandment I have for you, that you love one another as I have loved you. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And he goes, and we see that. Okay. Summarize it into two. But the last imperative verb to come out of his mouth before he ascends into heaven is make disciples in such a way as the disciples that you make by God's grace, remember, one waters, one sows, one waters, God gives the increase. Make disciples by God's grace in such a way that they will know when they confess faith in Christ that they have begun the journey of following Christ, which means having a student attitude, being willing to be faithful to his commandments, and to make other disciples. That's the hope of Christianity, of the survival of Christianity. Had the first century churches, with all their messes, been predominantly consumer-minded churches, they would have died and we'd know nothing about Christianity today. But thank God, the mindset in the majority of the people in these early churches that were started was to make disciples. That's why when you read, by the way, you read historically, you read about the apostles. And then you read about a group called the Apostolic Fathers. I mean, if you come across that or not, but the Apostolic Fathers, who were they? And they wrote volumes, by the way. There's the post-Nicene, the all these different volumes of their writings. Who were they? They were the disciples of the apostles. They taught them. And they taught others. And by the way, think about your salvation. Think about how and when you were saved. Whether it was under the preaching of the gospel, whether it was sitting on the lap of your mom, whether it was in a Sunday school class, whether it was in a different setting. When the gospel came to you, it came to you, whatever way it did, by someone who was taking seriously being a disciple. Longing to make disciples. None of us were saved just sitting under a tree contemplating life. We were all saved as a result of someone engaging us with the life-changing gospel of the crucified and risen Jesus Christ. And that's what Paul's talking about here. You're either the field of God right now, where someone has sown in you, and I'm doing my best failingly to sow the good news of Jesus Christ upon you. And if you know a Christian and you're not converted, that Christian is watering the gospel that's been sown into you with his or her tears for your salvation. My mother wept over me. Trembled over me. And though she had gone forth weeping, bearing the precious seed of the gospel that she so faithfully sowed into my life, the day came by God's grace when she came again rejoicing, bringing the fruit of that gospel sowing with her So you're either the field being cultivated, or you're in the field sowing and watering. There is no other place allowed by Scripture for a Christian to be. We have to ask ourselves, where are we? You're either in God's building being grown up. Peter talks about it. He says, as you come to Him, the living stone, you as living stones are being built up into a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people peculiar to God. John Owen, one of the Puritans, said of that passage hundreds of years ago, he said, this living stone will not accept nor acknowledge any dead stones in the building he is building. He only builds his building out of living stones, not dead stones. So what Paul is telling the Corinthians here is so critical for us to know, to renew a knowledge of it, to learn it at a more depth of convictional level, is that stop fussing about who your favorite preacher is and invest that same energy in growing in spirituality so that you can take in and receive meat, so that you do grow and that Corinth doesn't become some sort of aberrant expression of Christianity, where everybody's in spiritual diapers, even those who should be the leaders. And recognize God's means. We sow, we water, we build. Because God, Christianity is to be vital, not static. That's why we're talking about vital behaviors, by the way. These vital behaviors are not, they're not a clever acrostic. I didn't make it up when I came across it during my reading back in the fall. It just struck me as, here's where we're short-circuiting. Vital behaviors. Some of the things you do today that are so productive in your life are behaviors, habits that you've cultivated. And some of the things that, about yourself that drive you crazy are habits that you've developed that you're trying to break. That's just how God works. If it's not going to be jackrabbit Christianity where you first come to know the Lord and go, whee, and jump as high as you can and then kind of land, and it's not going to be that, then it's going to be the conducting of vital behaviors, of blessing, intentionally blessing. I've told you before, every one of you who knows the Lord, I probably in the course of a week blesses somebody just going through the motions. That's good, but that's not cultivating the behavior. Intentionally blessing. And some of you are catching hold of this. Somebody told me the other day, they said, oh, I had one of my cards out, was going to give it to this guy, and got involved in something else, and forgot. There it was, right there. That's begin to think differently, you see. That's thinking differently. Blessing. Eating, as Brother Norman talked about this morning. Not eating with your family. We expect you to feed your family. Look, fed my family 3 meals a day this week. Well, bless God, but you should. It's a good habit to have. Family appreciates it, by the way. But we're talking about feeding, meeting and eating with others. I think one of our brothers here looks for opportunities to feed the homeless. That's a world of difference from feeding your family. You see? To eat. Something we do anyway. If we said fast, it'd be a whole different thing, wouldn't it? Oh, fasting. Oh, eating. We do that. Listening. Part of spirituality is listening to the Spirit of God, getting quiet before Him and say, as that hymn says, Lord, speak to me that I may hear. We're not talking about something mystical like yoga or something. We're simply talking about quiet. Silence and solitude, our friend Don Whitney calls it. Listening to learn more about God's heartbeat so that that heartbeat increasingly consumes and takes over your heartbeat. And then learning of Jesus Christ. Yes, knowledge of Christ is wonderful, but not knowledge stored up as an end in itself so you can win at Bible trivia. Knowledge of Christ, to be more like Him, that precious Romans 8 chain of grace, that we might be conformed to the image of His Son. God-centered thinking, right? To learn to think more like Christ, to have this mind in us, which was also in Christ Jesus, to think on the things that reflect the best about the glory of Christ and His person and His work to a world that thinks in the gutter, if it thinks at all. And to live as someone sent, to increasingly cultivate the habit that when you go somewhere, as my friend R.F. Gates again said, brother, said, Bill, when you go to the store to get green beans, you're not there primarily to get green beans. In God's providence, the need for green beans is what got you there. When you go to get your hair cut, you're not there primarily for a haircut. It was the need of that that God used to get you there. You've been sent by the Savior. That's in the normal traffic patterns. Then to cultivate that, going out of the normal traffic patterns, getting out of the comfort zone, to go into places as a sent one with a message that if you don't declare it, those folks may not hear it. That's what Paul's talking about here. Grow in the field. Develop as a disciple. Grow in the building. Keep aligning your life to the cornerstone, Jesus Christ, not to these other things. Because there's something really interesting. One of the intriguing ironies of life is that when we deny ourselves and go out of our way to bless others, we experience joy. And so I saw this acrostic years ago. I thought this was interesting. You see, joy comes. True joy, not that temporal joy that's like cotton candy, that you like it, but you realize when you finish, you need to go brush your teeth and you're probably going to be upset at your stomach. True joy comes when you intentionally, habitually put Jesus first, okay? Jesus first, cornerstone. Consciously, intentionally, cultivating the habit of aligning your life, my life, to the cornerstone. Then you put others next. That's what Jesus did. This Friday night when we have our joint Good Friday service, I hope you're going to be there for that. Please come. We're doing the seven last words of Jesus. We've been given 3 minutes each. You ought to come just to watch me speak 3 minutes. That would be worth it, I think. 3 minutes each. And mine is the word from the cross where He said, woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. Dying in unspeakable agony on the cross. Keenly aware of pain, He takes the time to focus on others. Jesus, others, and then the right place. where yourself needs to be. You see? You. You get that out of whack? You may experience what the Bible calls pleasures of a season, but you won't have joy. You won't have it. So let's hear Paul on this. Let's take it to heart and apply it to our journey today. Your journey individually, your journey as a family, our journey as a congregation. Dear God, may the world see us as people full of joy, not strife, not jealousy, full of joy. And as we strive to have joy on your terms, obvious that we're taking Jesus first, raising our awareness level of others, denying ourselves so that we come in behind that. Blessing, eating, listening, learning, living sent. I pray that for myself. I want to increasingly be recognized that way. I want that for you too. I want that for you too because that's the path to joy in your life. And I want it for you too because that is the way the gospel squares us as a congregation. Let's pray together. Dear Holy Father, you're the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And thankful for those who have had the role in our lives of sowing gospel seed, watering it with their tears. Thankful most of all that you were pleased to use them as tools and gave the increase in terms of the salvation of our souls. And I pray that you will make us increasingly disciple makers and that we will discover that that is the path, in your providence, that's the path to real and lasting joy. For we ask this in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen.